Advaita Vedanta is Asparsha Yoga. It's also a yoga, a spiritual path. But what kind of spiritual path? A unique spiritual path, which is called the path of no contact. Why the path of no contact? Because, you see, Brahman and the world are not enemies. The real and the false are not enemies. You might think that reality and falsity are enemies. No. What is an enemy of falsity is the knowledge of reality. You see, the false snake and the real rope are not enemies. They are not contradictory. It is because of the real rope that you can mistake it and see it as a snake. The desert is not an enemy of the mirage water. It is because the desert exists that we have the illusion of a mirage water. What contradicts the mirage, the water in the mirage, or what contradicts the false snake? Our knowledge that it is a rope, our knowledge that it's a mirage, it's not really water, that contradicts. So knowledge of reality is the enemy of falsity. But reality as such is not the enemy of falsity. In fact, reality is very kind. It tells falsity, you come and settle down here, I have no problem. Make your house here. After all, if it is true that Vedanta is at all true, then we are Brahman. When? Now. So after realization? After realization, certainly. But before realization, you are not Brahman. You are Brahman right now. What is this world? It is Brahman. It is the Absolute right now. But there is nowhere. We have no idea about the Absolute. Brahman, the Absolute right now, is the ground of the appearance of this world. This world appearance has no enmity with Brahman. It is because of Brahman that this world is appearing. It is because of Brahman that we have samsara. The knowledge of Brahman is the enemy of samsara. Brahmajnana is the enemy of samsara, not Brahman itself. Brahman itself has no enmity with samsara. Why? Because there is no real contact between Brahman and samsara. Samsara cannot disturb Brahman. Samsara cannot harm Brahman. The rope, the false snake, cannot harm the rope. Does the rope become poisonous because of the false snake? No. Shankaracharya says, the water in the mirage, in Sanskrit, Marumarichika, the water in the mirage, all the water in the mirage is not sufficient to wet even a single grain of sand in the desert. Right? Because it's not really there. So the appearance, the false world, cannot do any harm to you, the real you. Because there is no point of contact between reality and falsity. Because reality is all that exists. If two things exist, then there's a question of contact. If two things exist, but two things do not exist, it only seems to be two because when you try to enlighten a person, when you give a teaching, the person knows the world. Then you have to introduce something called God. And then finally show that it is God alone which is appearing as you and the world. But first, it seems there are two things now, world and God. Person knows, I am body and mind. Then you have to introduce something called Atma, self. Then the person thinks, okay, this is not the self, there is something called the self. But after enlightenment, that self alone appears as body and mind. Don't you alone appear as the dreamer's body and the dream person in the dream? All of that is you alone. So, it is actually one reality. And the feeling of two, it is in between interim stage. The example which I gave about the pot and the clay and the pot. First there is a pot. And then we are told that the constituent of this pot is clay. There is a cause, a material cause of this pot, and that is called clay. At this point, you will start thinking there are two things. There is a pot and there is clay. Then you examine the pot and you find top to bottom, inside, outside, it's all clay. In fact, you are hard-pressed to find anything called pot. Because every real thing there is clay. Every bit of it is clay. There is no such separate thing as pot. And finally, you realize it is clay and clay alone. Pot is a name. It's a form. It's a particular use. Nama Rupa Vyavahara. The real problem comes if you stop halfway. If you're told, here is a pot and there's a reality called clay, then you start thinking, okay, there's a pot and clay. Then you are in trouble. Alan Watts calls it the clay pot theory becomes the crackpot theory. Why? If you stop at this point, what happens is then you are all the time searching for some God somewhere, which is the cause of this universe. Or when you look inside, and like the Hindu dualists, the Nayayikas do, body, mind, and some self, some Atma is there separately. You keep searching. So clay pot theory becomes crackpot theory then. That is the problem. If you stop at this point, that is why the yogis say you have to blank out the world to realize the self. Because they think there are two things. You have to shut your eyes to the... Do you really have to shut your eyes to this lectern to see the wood here? If I say, see the podium, say, yes, Swami. If I say, see the wood here, you'll say, yes, Swami, it's pretty easy. Do you have to shut your eyes to see the wood? No. To see the waves in the ocean, go to the beach? Yes, with open eyes. To see the water, do you have to shut your eyes? No. With open eyes, you can see the water. It's a change in paradigm. It's a change in your understanding. The shift is internal. The yogi, because he thinks water and wave are separate things. Gold and ornaments are separate things. You have to shut your eyes, then you can see the reality. So I'll end with a beautiful verse, Asparsha Yoga. That now we understand why it is called no contact. Because there's one reality. Does the clay ever come in contact with the pot? Now you'll understand. The clay never comes in contact with anything called pot. The pot is a construct which we think of. The clay in that form, we call it a pot. There is no thing called pot with which the clay will come in contact. So the clay is asparsha. It has no contact with the pot. Brahman, Atman, pure consciousness is asparsha. It has no contact with this appearance of the world. So Gaudapada has this beautiful verse, a slightly mischievous verse at the end, where he pokes fun at the yogis. He says, Asparsha yoga vai nama durdarsham sarva yogi bhi yogino bibhyati yasmat abhaye bhaya darshina. This teaching is called Asparsha Yoga, the path of no contact. And it is very difficult for yogis to understand this. It's very difficult for yogis to understand this. Why? The yogis are afraid of this path, are scared of this path, because they see fear in the fearless. Abhaye bhayadarshina. They are the ones who see fear in the fearless. Open your eyes, see the picture of the princess of Kashi. No, you will be attracted to that. Don't open your eyes, keep your eyes closed. No. So, abhaye bhayadarshina. They see fear in the fearless. Once you realize this as Brahman, you are the fearless. This world itself is the fearless. There is no fear here. Sri Ramakrishna says, people call it, he uses two words, dhokartati, this world is a place of deceit and fraud. He says, but I see it as Mojarkuti, a mansion of mirth. What is the mansion of mirth? This world itself, after realization, after enlightenment. This world itself is Brahman, the mansion of mirth.